us now is Megan Day. She is a staff writer at the Jacobin magazine. Megan, thanks so much for being here. How are you?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing really well. It's great to be talking with you. Was just saying to you in the break, I've always learned a lot speaking with you and reading your writing. You have a new piece out in Jacobin called Capitalism is Ruining Science. And you actually start with an observation that seems like it might come as a shock to the Steve Pinkers of the world, which is that science actually predated markets. Can you explain this basic history to us?
Yeah, I think that's true. The observation that I make is really that the university existed before capitalism.
Right.
The point being that, you know, the university doesn't necessarily operate by market logics, or at least it hasn't all throughout its history. It's often been devoted to other more noble aspirations than maximizing profit and accumulating wealth, and including those of science, right? Like discovering truths about the world around us that can help us build on our collective body of knowledge and better our world. But, you know, as I point out in the piece, there has been a recent trend in the academy toward market logics, toward the dictates of the capitalist market. And we see increasingly that universities are succumbing to market logic, and that therefore science is as well.
So get into that more specifically. Is this about, you know, is it about winning grants? Is it about publish or perish for individual academics? Is it about the need to generate R&D research that can benefit pharma or weapons manufacturers? Kind of get us through the different facets of how these incentive structures are taking over the scientific enterprise.
Yes, definitely. So that's the main thrust of the piece. So I start out by basically pointing out that Ellen Meiksins Wood is a theorist of capitalism, and she has what she calls a few dictates of the capitalist market, imperatives of competition, accumulation, profit maximization, and increasing labor productivity. And we see all of those increasing in academic science. So primarily, we see that with publish or perish, which is a common maxim, meaning that you need to increase your volume of publications of scientific papers or else your career is going down the toilet. Another thing, though, is funding or famine. This is like the next level above publish or perish. It's, you need to secure funding for your research or else you're not going to be eligible for yet more funding. So that sends scientists on a sort of mad scramble for funding. And the reasons that these things are happening is that, there's a lot of reasons. One is that obviously just our entire society is becoming more and more subservient to these dictates of the capitalist market. But specifically in universities, there is there's a drying up funding stream from tax money. So like public money is not going to universities the way that it once did due to austerity-minded regimes, administrations. So that means that universities are compelled to play by, you know, not public rules, public sector rules, but private sector rules. That means they have to operate like businesses. And businesses, of course, are all about the bottom line. And the health of the bottom line depends on profit maximization. So that, and it's a science itself, right? Like profit maximization depends on careful and constant evaluation of inputs and outputs. There's a sort of math and a science to it. But the result is that there's been the introduction of a new regime of quantitative performance metrics in universities, and it governs almost everything that scientific researchers do, and it has observable impacts on their work practices. So like you mentioned, there are a lot of different quantitative performance metrics. One is publication count, like I said, you know, publish or perish. Citations are being relied upon in professional evaluations in ways that they never were before. And including combined citation publication counts, so like where you appear, how often you appear in indexes, and so on. And then things like that I don't totally understand because I'm not an academic scientist, but the things with names like a journal impact factors, and then you also have you know, total research dollars. So this is where we get into funding or famine. And then we've also got patents, which you mentioned before as well, you know, R&D research. So these quantitative metrics are sort of dominating decision making in everything from, you know, hiring new faculty to promoting professors to tenure to also awards and also to funding.
So let's indulge, and well, actually, this will kind of fuse well with a question of, because you cite research that's showing, in fact, the raw amount of scientific research and productivity is increasing in correlation with this regime. And there is definitely a, you know, the very standard response that you would get, and certainly from the sort of mainstream purveyors of quote-unquote science, and I am thinking specifically of Steve Pinker, but I think even also the kind of cult and mythology around Elon Musk, would say, well, science is increasing, quote-unquote. We need constant innovation, and, you know, two things. One, you know, boo-hoo professors, you know, do your work like everybody else. That's the one very typical kind of punitive neoliberal logic. And then that number two, even if you, they might even say, okay, even you coffee shop, you know, Jacobin lefties, you don't like Raytheon or Pfizer or whatever, but even you would say that, as an example, the internet was a publicly funded, government-driven project, and that's a big point for our side on the socialist end of the equation. And at the same time, it was very much a military project, and one, you know, that was a byproduct of, you know, research that was centered on the military-industrial complex. So they might say, even if you don't like that the R&D is so much going into the corporate sector, that research will still have a spillover effect, not only in markets and product innovation, but just in general raw science. And now you can obviously tell my editorial a little bit in this, because I've really gotten sick of the discourse that just science is like some type of, ironically, like mystical spiritual thing with like its own innate value, versus like specific things like debunking dogmas, creating medicines, which are very good things. But if you don't politicize the concept, you have just this kind of blind faith in science as a teleology, basically. But that being said, the two responses, I think, would be the more science, the better. Maybe you could respond to the quality of the science that's being produced. And that number two, there will be a spillover effect regardless, because, again, essentially more science, better.
Right. Yeah. I mean, maybe we could call that approach trickle-down science. And I don't think it's, you know, any more sound than trickle-down economics. I think that you have to make political choices from the outset about where you're going to allocate resources and how, in order to improve public well-being, right? Like pursuing science for the well-being of the public is very different than pursuing science for the well-being of corporations' profits. Right. So to go back to your first thing, though, which is the question of quantity. Yeah. Apparently, scientific output, if you measure it by work citations, has doubled every 9 years since roughly World War II. This is from a paper that I cite extensively in my article. The paper is called Academic Research in the 21st Century: Maintaining Scientific Integrity in a Climate of Perverse Incentives and Hyper-Competition. It's a long title, but it's a great paper, and the authors are Mark Edwards and Siddhartha Roy. And their observation was that actually quantity does not translate to quality. In fact, on the contrary, if you track the effect of these quantitative performance metrics that I was talking about before on the quality of scientific research, you'll find that it has a detrimental effect. So as a result of, for instance, reward systems that incentivize publication volume, scientific papers have become shorter, they're less comprehensive, and they boast worse methods and an increase also in false discovery rates. Another one is, you know, in response to like the growing emphasis on work citations and professional evaluations, which I talked about a moment ago, reference lists have become bloated to meet career needs, not to meet, you know, the needs of the work itself. And there's an increasing number of peer reviewers requesting that their own work be cited as a condition of publication. And after I published this article, I actually heard from someone who had just gone through this a few days prior, that she was trying to get her paper published in a peer-reviewed journal, and reviewer number two stepped in and said, I really think that this work needs to build more on my work, right? And and so you see the way in which, but the reason that reviewer number two was saying this, obviously, is because reviewer number two is under a lot of stress and a lot of pressure to get more citations in order to improve their own career prospects.
Right.
So you see that this actually erodes the integrity and the quality of the work, because when people are experiencing a sort of like precarity, and when they're in competition over scarce resources, their priorities change. They're no longer able to simply focus on the integrity of the work. They have to focus on their own bottom line, as the university is focusing on its bottom line. So it becomes everybody race to the bottom. And there's a couple of more ways in which this happens. One is that, you know, there's a system right now increasingly where you reward increased grant funding with more professional opportunities for increased grant funding. So like the more money you get, the more money you're likely to get. It shows the money is sort of like an award. It shows that you are worth putting money into. And that's the way in which a lot of academic scientists are actually funding their careers. This is because obviously we're seeing funding streams dry up from the public sector. Due to austerity and due to privatization. You could call this a form of privatization. But what it results in is scientists spending an outsized amount of their time writing grant proposals, which is not the amount of time. I mean, you should be spending that time thinking about complex, deep questions and looking for complicated truths. And you also see scientists overselling the positive results of their research to catch the attention of funders, because funders don't want to fund things where, you know, the hypothesis was proven untrue, or where, you know, essentially no information was found, which is good information. When no new information was found using the scientific method, that's actually technically good information in science, but it's not good information in the world of grants. They want to see results that they can package and they can put on their website and they can sell, right?
Yep.
So you see, you actually do see scientists overselling, like I said, the positive results of their research, which actually compromises the integrity of the entire scientific endeavor, I think. And then the final one is that, as Edwards and Roy point out, when universities reward departments for ranking highly, which is something that happens a lot, it's kind of like with No Child Left Behind, you know, with like, you know, grade school. If the departments rank highly, they get, you know, more money. And this actually incentivizes departments to, as Edwards and Roy say, reverse engineer game and cheat rankings. And they see sort of observable effects of this, and they map this out in their paper. And that, of course, also erodes the integrity of scientific institutions themselves. So this is a long, winding way to say that the trickle-down effects of whatever sort of like R&D investment we see is, I think, dwarfed by the incredible crisis in academic science, the crisis of integrity, that is.
Right. So you basically, it's going to be like less discovering, you know, the structure of DNA and more Thanos or whatever the hell that thing was called, essentially.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah.
I believe she's actually mounting a comeback, if I understand correctly. But
great.
Yeah. No,
bring her back.
Yeah, totally. Well, she makes for good grant copy. You have a great, you cite and translate research really, really well in this piece. And usually, as always, is typical of your work. But you also have a kind of really great personalized case study of this. And it's a gentleman by the name of Peter Higgs, who won a Nobel Prize in 2013. Now, if you were just looking at this from the outside, you know, one would assume that somebody whose research going back to the 60s, which culminated in a Nobel Prize, would be the toast of his department and, you know, insulated in sort of, you know, acolytes and professional and social recognition. But actually, no.
Right. On the contrary, so Peter Higgs, I should say, he's the British theoretical physicist who, in 1964, he predicted the existence of the Higgs boson particle, sometimes called the God particle, which he doesn't like. But anyway, you might recognize it. He won the Nobel Prize in 2013 for that work that he had done in the 60s. And after winning, he sat down with The Guardian, and on his, you know, sort of inaugural interview, they basically were like, do you have anything to say, Peter Higgs, about academic science? And instead of saying what you might expect him to say, he said, quote, it's difficult to imagine how I would ever have enough peace and quiet in the present sort of climate to do what I did in 1964. Today, I wouldn't get an academic job. It's as simple as that. I don't think I would regard it as productive enough. And he also said that in the latter years of his career at Edinburgh University, he became, quote, an embarrassment to the department when they did research assessment exercises. So they would send around an email saying, please give us a list of your recent publications. And he would send back a statement saying, nothing, none. I don't have any recent publications. And according to him, the university kept him around despite his insufficient productivity, solely in the hopes that he would win the Nobel Prize, which would then be a boon to the brand of the university in this contemporary sink or swim environment where there's more austerity and less public funding. So Peter Higgs basically narrowly escaped the fate of being given the axe solely on the basis that he had conducted research in the 1960s under a completely different climate, which had led to major breakthroughs in theoretical physics. I think that that's a really interesting case study, because one of the things also is he basically speaks to that point I mentioned earlier, which is if you're chasing grants and citations, you're losing opportunities for careful contemplation and deep exploration.
That's I think what's amazing and so fast and disturbing but elegant about that is when you bring in essentially like the time politics dimension of it, and the discipline and regimes that basically capitalism instills in people to, you know, hyper efficient, you know, limit them and constrain them as workers, but then also rob them of any time to be fully developed human beings, which of course spills into their work, if one is allowed to have it spill into their work, and you do a type of work like theoretical physics where you do actually, you know, literally sort of need that time. But it kind of perfectly bridges the whole chain of how science is being distorted by capitalism, because you could take, you know, examples that we've already known, you know, for quite some time, like why is it that there's so little R&D and research, you know, that's sort of desperately underfunded to deal with things like malaria, as an example. Well, because there isn't a market for that kind of drug research. It primarily, affects poor people in underdeveloped economies. So why would we put our research into that? And if the universities and the commons and the public sector are undermined, and pharma's driving the show, there's not going to be solutions for those sort of problems. And then that actually runs up the chain to, this is somebody who really actually revealed something about like the foundations of our universe and where we came from, you know, these kind of really deep things that are also really important. And he's saying, I wouldn't have been able to give this to you in this environment. And that's kind of a mind-blowing, like, we wouldn't learn something that is foundational to like the whole game of us even being here to begin with because of like some type of new dumb citation metric. I mean, let that sink in.
Right. I mean, it's, and even it's not that we, you say we wouldn't learn something.
Yeah, maybe we would.
We aren't learning things right now. There are things right now that we're missing out on because there are brilliant scientists who are spending their time doing things other than finding out the deep, complex truths of our universe, right? So I think that this is a problem that we're actually experiencing the negative effects of quietly right now. We have more brilliant people with more institutional support and more basic fundamental knowledge to work from than ever in human history. And yet we also are not seeing the fruits of that fully come to bear because we are basically distracting these people, selling their own labor on a market instead of, you know, sitting and thinking and working and quietly sort of searching for the more complex truths that govern our universe.